Terrific. See this way. You go over here this way. That there. And you put fade. And fade mark the other end. And back to the sound. And I'll make sure it's on. Make the main one. That's the one that's coming in. Sometimes the fade mark the other end. He's gone. Don't take that now. Thank you.
I symbolises an unplanned risk of 45. Her last words.
He took the bread and said the blessing, and he broke it and handed it to them. Their eyes were opened and they recognized him, but he had vanished from their sight. Then they said to each other, did not our hearts burn within us as he talked to us on the road and explained the scriptures to us? They set out that instant and returned to Jerusalem, but they found the 11 assembled together with their companions who said to them, yes, it is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon. Then they told the story of what had happened on the road and how they had recognized him for breaking the bread. The Gospel of the Lord. As I said at the beginning, we come here today to celebrate and to give thanks for the gift of life given by God to Kathy. A life which was full, a life that was surrounded by family and friends and neighbours, a life into bedrock of faith. I welcome Angela and her husband Vic and Kathy's grandchildren Maya, Rowan and Aaron, and I welcome her sister and brothers Nancy, Pat, Jim and Tom and their families, and all who gathered here this morning, and also Father Casey, Archpriest of Carnew. We come here to pray for the happy repose of her soul, that God, who begun the good work in her on the day of her baptism, would now bring it to fulfillment in the eternal life and promise of heaven. And in our thoughts and prayers also today, we remember her husband Owen, and their son Colin, and her sister and brothers who predeceased her. We come as a parish community, as an assembly of different people from different places who are for these short few moments united in prayer, united in solidarity with Kathy's family, and united in the grace of God, a grace poured out in abundance on Kathy in her life. Kathy's death has brought us together and has united us in prayer. Our Gospel is the story of the disciples on the road to Emmaus. It is a reminder of the journey of life, and two things stand out. Firstly, the stories and conversations that Jesus had with his disciples on the road, and secondly, the presence of Jesus on that journey, even though the disciples failed to recognize him. As Irish people, we love stories, especially stories of our own families, especially stories told at wakes, memories that are precious, and memories that are reaffirmed the love that that person was held in over her life. The death of someone we love causes us to reflect and draw out from the hidden places of our minds and hearts the stories of that person's life and our relation with them. Thankfully, our memories are selected, and we draw out only those memories which make us smile and laugh and make us reflect on the profound effect that that passing person has had in our life, the profound effect that Kathy had on all of us here. The second image that comes from the story of Emmaus is the presence of Jesus walking with the disciples, even though they didn't recognize him. Throughout her life, Kathy knew that Jesus was present with her. Even if sometimes she failed to recognize him, she was sure that he would be present with her in the sacrifice of the Mass to which she was devoted. There is no more fitting way to celebrate her life than to do so by the breaking of bread. For it is in this Eucharist that we all recognize Christ and learn to hope ourselves for the gift of the reward of eternal life when our time comes. Today she rests in the heart of God. Her life ended, eternal life just beginning. Every year Kathy would ring me and ask me to say Mass for Owen and for Colin. I had her number stored in my phone, but she could never mistake the fact that it was Kathy. She was always pleasant, always asking after the parish, always grateful for the little that I could do for her. This was her earnest work, that not only would she and her family pray for them, but that the whole parish community would do likewise. The phone call and the Masses were an act of faith on Kathleen's part. She had a belief in the power of prayer. She had a strong faith. She believed in the resurrection and the triumph of Jesus over death. Death would never just be the end. Death would never be the last word. The promise of eternal life was there for those who believed it. For Kathleen, it was the prayer that was on her lips for her husband and son who had gone before her. A prayer that they would live eternally in the place of life, are struggling to live holiness as life it is for all of us, the all too human, all too frail attempts that we make to draw ourselves closer to God. However, we should never forget that regardless of our best efforts, our Heavenly Father is always close to us, constantly drawing us to Himself, constantly calling us to reassure us of His love, His mercy, His providence, and His presence. In the words of St. Thérèse of Lisieux, holiness does not consist in this or that practice, but rather in a disposition of the heart that makes us always humble and little in the arms of God, well aware of our frailty, but wholly confident of His Father with us. It was this strong faith that helped her cope with difficult days in her life, and this faith which kept her pleasant and cheerful. Kathy sets all an example of what Christian faith should be: trusting God, love of neighbour, and love of the Saviour who loved us first. Another reason for the annual anniversary mass was so, as I said, the parish community would pray for them also. She did so much for the community during her life that it was only right and proper that we should do this for her in return. As we have in the past, and so we will now, and as we will into the future, we pray for the happy repose of her soul, and we pray that she is united with those whom she grieved for in life. In her commitment to this parish, she was to the fore. She was never daunted when she would be out selling tickets, even heading out far beyond the parish boundaries. She was an enthusiastic and conscientious member of the folk group, whose presence we appreciate this morning. St. Augustine said that those who sing pray twice, and for Kathleen, it wasn't just about the singing, it was the social part of it as well. She loved coming to choir, to meet and to chat, and to sing the glory of God with all her strength and enthusiasm. And it was that social aspect, the need and the grace of friends and community, which made the last years of her life so rich in Carnoue, safe and secure, and surrounded by people she considered good friends. To finish, summarize, as we contemplate what now for Kathy is the reality of eternal life, but for us, the unknown, undiscovered country, but nonetheless, the hope of all Christians. And I said to the man who stood at the gate of the year, "Give me light that I may tread safely into the unknown." And he replied, "Go out into the darkness and put your hand in the hand of God. That shall be to you better than light and safer than known way." So I set forth, and finding the hand of God, trod gladly into the light. And he led me toward the hills and the breaking of day in the low east. So heart be still, what need our little life, our human life, to know if God hath comprehension in all the dizzy strife of things both high and low, God hideth his intention. Eternal rest grant unto her, O Lord, and let perpetual life shine upon her, may she rest in peace. May the souls of the soul of all the dead depart, and the mercy of God rest in peace. Now I invite you to stand, and those who are on Jesus in prayer.
May she live eternally in happiness and light of God's presence. Glory to
you.
acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Be near, O Lord, we pray to your servant Catholic. On this funeral day, we offer you the sacrifice of consideration, so that should any state of sin have come to her, or any human fault have affected her, it may, by your loving gift, be forgiven and wiped away. Through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
With
your spirit. Your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life has changed and not ended, and when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so are the angels and archangels, the thrones and dominions, with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing to him your glory, as without end we have thanked. Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are filled with your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest. Let us kneel. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and holy, created, right, teaching praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. You never cease to gather people to yourself, so that through the rising of the sun to the setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said a blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to the second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with this Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
May we make God's name honor offering to you, so we may obtain the inheritance of your elect, especially the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Blessed Joseph, our spouse, your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with all the saints, in whose constant intercession, your life and faith. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation and prayer of war advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to have firm in faith and charity, your Christian Church on earth, your servant Francis, our Pope, and John, our Bishop, the Order Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people of your gain for your own. This invasion prepares his family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, and most merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world.
Remember your servant, Kathleen, whom you have called today from this world to yourself. Grant that she who is united with your Son in death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth you will raise up in the flesh those who have died, and transform our lowly bodies after the pattern of his own glorious to our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who are pleasing to you from at their passing from this life, give kind of riddance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you as our God as you are, we shall become like you for all the ages, and praise you without end through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Let us stand and let us say this command, before my mind teach you, we dare to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we wait the blessed hope of the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I leave you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The Lord be with you. Lamb of God. For anyone who might need that there are celiac posts there, you need to come up and see yourselves.
son passed away too soon. Catherine was left to bring up Angela from Roscoff, something she did admirably, despite having to contain the rose of grief. In 1997, she became a mother-in-law, which I know I've been very happy. But not as happy as becoming a grandmother in 2000, 2004, in 2007. In 2012, she moved to Tommy Community Care and thrived as a key pillar of that community. In 2013, she was contained in Roscoff, which had the real courage and faith of God to deal with that tragedy. She enjoyed good health until the last few months of her life, and sadly taken from us on Monday, 6th of February. So that's the timeline of Kathleen, and I want to speak for you this talking about Kathleen Johnson, a lady with five survivor siblings, one daughter, one son-in-law, three grandchildren, 35 nephews and nieces, countless godchildren, and more friends than anyone I know. And so it's why I'm here today, yesterday at the Way and Carmen Community Centre. Touched so many, many people. I first met Kathleen 34 years ago, as a non-conventional boyfriend to our only daughter living abroad, it's fair to say that I was a tad pensive for meeting her. I have no reason to fear. She welcomed me with open arms, and her love, friendship, and good nature, her trademarks, shone through from there onwards. Over the years, I was fortunate enough to know her very well, her warmth, her kindness, and her ability to always see the best in people, not to judge, just hugely inspirational. She never held a grudge. She always forgave and forgot, and the compassion was a real example for us all. One of the dearest souls she was, she just loved being with people, chatting, laughing, engaging with them. It's no surprise that anyone who was with her always wanted to stay longer and come. She had those real talents that made everyone feel good about themselves, they were smart. Yet, with this gentle character, with some of the real resilience, she never complained. She dealt with the hardest challenges that came her way with courage, with fortitude, and an eternally optimistic outlook. Whenever asked, "How are you, Kathy?" her response was always the same, "Never better." And I'm also the governor of that. As seen earlier, she had great sporting prowess, especially as an ambidextrous bowls champion, and it was touching and fitting to see the Guard of Honour at the Bowls Club yesterday. She was a famous baker, a huge number of prizes at all the local shows for her brown bread, scones and cakes. She was a shrewd and canny cards player, however, a twinkle in her eye or her face. She knew how to win. She loved spending afternoons and evenings indulging with passion. If that wasn't enough, she was a model extraordinaire, strutting stuff on the most iconic of fashion ladies, Victor Hill Capital. I believe when she came to Granny, she entered the glamorous Granny competition, obviously Barbara. But perhaps her two greatest passions were her faith and her family. She was a devout and committed Catholic, embodied strong Christian values.
sets it to remember that she was once a temple of the Holy Spirit. Since God comes to our aid, hasten to meet your angel from the Lord. May Christ, who calls you, take you to himself. May angels lead you to the bosom of Abraham.
Receive your soul and set you to God.
Eternal rest grant unto her, our Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon
you. Receive your soul and set you to God. Thank you.